Welcome again to this segment of the, gee whiz, the producer's show. Gee whiz, I was thinking I was still on the Oregon Voters Digest, but I'm all over the place, folks. And it's very, very important because, as you know, we're now right in the real midst of the election process. Most of us have been watching the presidential race, and it's pretty grueling, if you will. And so what I'm going to do, and this is what my show is going to be about tonight, I'm going to show you the difference in terms of what we're seeing and what we should be seeing. And what I mean by that is that you got the idea of what we're seeing. We're not really talking about the issues when you're looking at that presidential race aspect of it. We're interested in the issues. And from a historical standpoint, this particular election, the public is saying before the media got involved in the process, and the media was saying at that point in time that, look, we do not want any more politicians. We want people to talk to the issues. And as a result of that, there were some folks that got involved in this process this time around that were not politicians. They brought things to the table. And that's the issue that we're dealing with today. People who bring things to the table that would better our way of life, and people who basically traditionally from years, if you will, have been just basically politicians. Either they're waiting for some issues to come to the table, or they've got their own personal view or whatever. But the fact of the matter is, that's what we're dealing with today. And what I'm going to do is that tonight, what we're going to be doing with these two, my two guests right here, and I'll introduce them very shortly, is that these folks here, the people that I've got here with me, we're going to be talking about education. They bring something to the table. And it's kind of an interesting thing, because in most cases, let's say one of my guests, you've seen him before. You've seen both of them, for that matter. I've got Steve Buel here, who happens to sit on the Portland Public School Board. Now, in all due respect, Steve's had 40 years of experience. But you got to remember, even in the school board, you look at the school board, how many people have that kind of an experience? And so he brings something to the table. He's running for office. So really, realistically, he's really an outsider. But he has been in the process of running. He's run for office on several different occasions. He's been on the school board on two different occasions. I met him in that first half of his life, but he stayed there again, and I went somewhere else. I came back, and he was still there. You know what I mean? But my point is that Steve Buel brings 40 years of experience in educating and teaching kids. That's worth something, because the idea is that because at the end of the day, our education system is very, very important to our youth, our kids, because that's the bottom line. And as one would say, if you don't have something to be able to get along in this world, you have to be educated. You have to have a high school diploma. And if you're fortunate enough to go to college, and there's a big push on that piece. But the whole idea is that you have to be a learned person, if you will, if in fact you want to survive in this particular, in our country, if you will, and our lifestyle. And so that's what Steve brings to the table. He just happens to be running as a politician, because that's the process for getting on the school board. But as far as I'm concerned, he's more than qualified to be sitting up there with a group of other folks. So he brings something of worth, if you will, to the public. And so when you, again, I'm making that point. So therefore, when you are, quote, looking for someone, when you're getting all this stuff in the mail and this, that, and the other, look for that quality first. What does the person bring to the table? What does the person bring to the table so that these kids can be educated? Somebody with background, not the politicians. And I've seen that in many cases around. And he can pretty well share that with you about the kind of, let's put it away, the environment he has to deal with when he's sitting up on the school board with his other colleagues. And I'm not trying to knock them. I'm just saying, but my point is that everybody has their reasoning, if you will, for running for office. Steve, like I said, I'm looking at him. That's why he's sitting here. Of all the ones that are there, and all due respect, I've got respect for all these individuals. My thing is, I'm looking for what does he bring to the table that ultimately will educate these kids. And my second guest is Art Robinson. And what does he bring to the table as it relates to kids? Because Art was in a situation where he is a scientist in his own right, my point is that he lives in a rural area aspect of it. He taught his school. He taught his kids at school. I mean, at home, in his environment, if you will, as a scientist. Again, what does he bring to the table? So at the end of the day, Art has because of that, he's developed skills in the education of these kids. because in his environment, his kids graduated from schools and they went on to pick up PhDs and on and on and on. And during that particular time, he had voc ed because he taught them the trades of high tech and science and things of that nature. So my point is, and he happens to be, by the way, running for office. We're not talking about the politics of it right now, but the fact of the matter is, again, still, what does he bring to the table as it relates to educating the youth? Very, very important. Some folks have the option, go public schools. Some folks, maybe in liberal, some folks say, well, gee whiz, I don't feel too comfortable about certain areas of public schools, so I'm going to do it myself. Well, he went through the pain, if you will, of mixing his work with educating his kids. And that means that he still had to identify with the issues and the bottom line that creditized these young people, his kids, to be able to get a diploma and to be able to get a degree. So he also was in there, but he had to do it that way. Unlike Steve, he was in the system teaching school every day, but still, he's got his criteria. So I've got two individuals here, but again, the same thing, same thing. Now, he happens to be running for Congress, if you will, but again, too, education is huge. We spend a lot of money on education, and we're going to talk a little bit about that tonight, too. We got ballot measure that we got 98. We got the voc ed piece on that 97. Piece. We got 97. Again, it's the same old deal. And then and Steve and I, we've talked about this many times over, about the failure rates here in the largest school district in the state of Oregon. And it's a major, major concern. And he's constantly fighting to try to get that pretty well resolved, but it's a tough fight. So I'm just saying to you, this time, this election, I want you to really consider asking the person when they start sending you these flyers and mailers and whatever, if you can read, and ask that one question: what do you bring to the table to educate my kid so he can make it in our way of life? That's the bottom line. So that's why we're going to have this discussion. So now we've given you a feel about running for office. And we've given a feel about you as a responsible citizen, as a responsible voter. You are very concerned about your kids, what you should be learning. Just some ideas. And by the way, these are just opinions. You got to understand these opinions. And I'm going to get these guys to kind of give you a better feel of what a public school environment, like a Steve background or whatever, in terms of what he has done through the years. And right up front with it, he has goals too, in terms of his expectations of getting his points of views across while he's a board member. At the end of the day, he is very much concerned about the kids, bottom line, at the end of that day, okay? And the same thing with Art. So Art will share his experience as it relates to when he was spending his time, i.e. developing his part, but again, it's the same deal. It's about the kids, and he's still in the business. And he's still in the business, if you will, of sharing his background and his expertise in a homeschooling environment, and he'll share that. So why don't we? What do you think, huh? Did we do it? Was that a pretty good introduction?
Yeah,
Steve?
I probably should change my election model from make our schools great again back to something about my experience. I guess.
Are you just sharing that?
I thought the first one sounded pretty good. I think you should stick with the first one. It's good.
But I like that. That's good. Yeah, that's your goal now.
Yeah, right.
Well, look, why don't we start off with, Steve, why don't we start off with yourself? I mean, you know, let's just start off about, and in all due respect, share with, because you've spent 40 years in school, 40 years, and you're still in schools, but you happen to be sitting on the board. Fair? Okay, so let's talk a little bit about that.
Well, what do you want
where's
to know? What do
you
want to
know? You know, where's your passion? How did you get your passion? Why was the definition?
It started when I was about 6 years old, I guess.
Okay, but
really oriented towards schools.
Okay.
And when I became a teacher, and I took a look at a lot of things and said, I don't like how we're doing some of these things that aren't really directed towards children. And in fact, in the last few years, we're doing a lot more things that aren't directed toward children that are really worse than what we ever did. At least I think when I first started teaching, you had the idea that, okay? We're doing what's good for the kids, mm-hmm. and we've shifted a lot, particularly in the federal government and in the state government now, away from what's good for children to what's good for people making a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And there, a lot of that is still is really going on in the, both the federal government and the state government. Mm-hmm. And you can see it if you pay real careful attention. Part of the problem is you almost have to be in the schools to see how it plays out. It sounds good when our test scores go up, but what are the costs of that and why did they go up? Those types of things. And understanding and getting a background in that is kind of hard, because you've got some really powerful people in America and real powerful people in the state who are pushing a lot in the wrong directions, as opposed to educating children to go out and get a job and be a good citizen. Mm-hmm. We're mostly centered on what a lot of people think is good for, basically, in a way, corporate America.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
and we spend hundreds of millions of dollars to do testing, mm-hmm. which we, and like important public schools, we don't get anything from the testing. The smarter balanced testing that we do, we don't get anything. Mm-hmm. And so there's new fights now. Used to be, okay, you were oriented towards kids, we did stuff, there were some small fights. But now there's major fights that are really being destructive of our educational system, and Oregon has bought in with it.
Mm-hmm.
Oregon
mm-hmm.
Department of Education has bought in with it, and mm-hmm. it's a tough fight still. And so you've got all these things that you need to be doing, and yet you're having all this energy put someplace else, and it makes it tough. So
mm-hmm.
it
mm-hmm.
keeps me interested because I care about the educational system, but both in the state and in Portland.
But what about your colleagues? And I know you sort of shared it. Do you try to get those issues on the table with your colleagues on the board?
Oh, sure. I try and focus on particular different issues that I think are important.
Mm-hmm.
One recent one is, for years in Portland Public Schools, we didn't buy any library books through the school system, the district. If you got library books in your school, it was from book sales, the junior scholastic book sales, or maybe a little bit of money from the PTA. But we just let our libraries just go way downhill. And so those are issues like that you're fighting on. Now, one of the big issues in the schools right now is we have a lot of kids who come in from foreign countries who speak basically the foreign language,
mm-hmm.
and they know, they, many of them arrive with no English background.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll take them and put them in classrooms in the high school or even the middle school, say seventh or eighth grade classrooms, and then what are they going to get out of that? We need a program that teaches them English. And we do it in a very intense way. I'm trying to get us to do that. We have one that does about 35 kids, but we get way more than that. And so those types of issues that really directly impact the school and the children in there, they kind of get waved off with the testing and accountability ideas and all the demands from the state and so forth. You don't see the state working on getting those types of things that really make a difference to children necessarily.
Well, is that coming across with the other board members and from the standpoint of saying, hey, this is how we can fix the program, and I relate to what you're talking to?
Yeah, some solutions? Of it. Why got them to add library books? I'm working this next budget session trying to get us to change the budget so we budget from the schools out instead of from the administration to the schools, so you budget for the schools and get some equality across the programs and budget by program instead of by numbers, which in Portland Public Schools, you have the largest numbers in the more well-to-do schools, so they get a better program.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm trying to get them to change that. There's things that, and yeah, I get pretty good support from in a lot of things. I'm working in cohorts with other board members, but the opposition is powerful. You know, those hundreds of millions of dollars, the federal government telling you have to meet these standards, the idea that, okay, you've got your test scores up, that's wonderful, you've got your graduations up, that's wonderful, but how did you do that and how did that come about is a whole other ball game. And so the opposition's really powerful. Powerful people like to make a lot of money off the schools,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and people like to worry about their school. I'm not so worried about this one down here. So you get a lot of, you're fighting that, those problems all the time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I've got some pretty good colleagues on the board, and we're making some wonderful changes and doing some really great stuff. Right. But in my way of thinking, it's not fast enough. Mm-hmm. You know, we got distracted with the health issues, which we've been pushing underneath the table for, well, underneath the rug for years and years and years and years. Mm-hmm. And we lifted the rug, and out they came. Well, we're not really. Our board's a little discombobulated, don't really have four solid people who are going to go for this stuff. And so when we decided to address some really difficult problems, it's hard to address those problems. We're doing a pretty good job, I think, on the lead and a pretty good job on some of the safety issues, mm-hmm. and addressing them and really working on them for the first time in years and years in Portland. And so we're making progress, but it kind of, when you have to address all those difficult things, it takes away from other things, and it takes money away, and so those are really, they're really problem areas.
If I threw out the fact that, let's say, a proposal that says that the school board member, you got seven school board members on there right now, right? Let's say if you had four that had to be teachers, had at least had teacher's background, and the other three will say it an open, kind of trying to be as fair as possible, because in all due respect, it takes the teacher to teach the kids.
Well, and the fact that you're a teacher doesn't necessarily mean that you've got the right attitudes about stuff, because the testing is very powerful, and when you go into a school, often you've got teachers that are pretty skeptical and have got a lot of experience. Maybe you've got teachers that really don't. They're just focusing on their classroom and that's it, which is a good thing, and often they're really excellent teachers. And then you got teachers who want to get up or want to be the buddy of the principal and that type of thing. So and those are the teachers who often get chosen on committees in the state to be on those committees. And because they ask, they'll ask the principal to who's interested. Well, the principal's not going to send as skeptical people who are with a lot of experience. They're going to send those ones they can count on. And so there's kind of a thing within schools too that it's not, you're not guaranteed because you're a teacher that you're even a good person, of course. You know, teachers are just ordinary people that have graduated from college.
So there would be no way, if you will, of saying...
It wouldn't be necessarily any better. What's better is to find...
Well, at least they've gone through a system that says they know how to educate kids.
Yeah, yes. And one of the things that I did and I've actually accomplished is when I first came on the school board, we pretty much treated the teachers like they were the enemy. And I cut that changed, I think. Now when we have committees, we ask the teachers union, send us people to be on this committee. This committee at MIT, well, we want teachers, we want that input from teachers themselves. And so that has changed in Portland Public Schools, and it's changed immensely. They're no longer the enemy, now they're an ally that we're working together with. And so that and alone, if I did nothing else on the school board, I think I'm taking a lot of credit for that, because I really pushed and pushed and pushed and pushed for that.
But you've been there 40 years.
Well, yeah, but I mean, what I'm saying is, it's just not get teachers on there, it's get people with the right attitude, and the right attitude, I think, is in three places. One, you do what you think's right for kids. Two, you spend the taxpayers' money well as you can. And those are the one and two for me. And then the third thing, you really respect and are fair with your employees. Mm-hmm. If you have those attitudes, then you can do pretty well on the school board, and you're willing to stand up for all the children, which is the first one, not just the people in your neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Stand up for this school too, which is struggling. What are we going to do to stand up for them? So.
And then naturally, the feel is at the end of the day, the end result from the voter standpoint, and from the moms and dad, is my kid educated and can they make it in this world? Fair?
In the end, yeah.
At the end of the day.
That's what I mean.
Right?
That's when you put those kids up front and you do what's best for those children, and it's the best for those children and their education.
But then we're still stuck in this piece about the number of folks who do graduate in there.
We're still stuck in that arena. Not always for the reasons that people think we're stuck in it, though.
Okay. But I'll tell you what.
We're often stuck in it because in Portland, we have had not very good middle grade education, because kids in the middle grades now, they come out and they've got a different attitude about it. They're more difficult to educate than they were 30 years ago, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And you've got to engage them in school. Well, in order to engage them in school, you have to have things that engage them. Mm-hmm. And we haven't ever really picked up on that. We do a really pretty good job in our high schools. If you have a kid who's kind of motivated and you can get into high school, you can get a pretty good education. And in the lower grades, it depends on how good the teacher is. Generally, if you're a second grader and you got a really good teacher, then you'd probably do pretty good. But in the middle grades, you have to engage children in school. Mm-hmm. And we don't do a very good job of that yet.
Okay, so that's where you are now. Okay, tell you what, now that we've spent some time with Steve, we're gonna bring Art here on the table now, and we're gonna give him an opportunity to talk about his experience in regards to homeschool and his rationale for getting in that arena and how he's worked in his life. And at the end of the day, he had some success and he's still doing it. Art?
Well, my experience in education.
Speak up a little bit.
Aside from going to school myself, really started in the university.
Okay.
I taught undergraduates, graduate students, and postdoctoral students at UC San Diego and Stanford. So I was looking at teaching people coming out of the K-12 schools.
Okay.
After my wife was also a scientist, but we decided to homeschool. So she started homeschooling them, but when they were ages 1.5 to 12, she died. So I became the teacher of the homeschool.
Mm-hmm.
That was my first experience really with teaching K-12 students. And it worked out pretty well for us. They all got college degrees in science and 5 of them have doctorates. But in doing that, our whole family became very interested in K-12 education. And we produced a curriculum, books, started for homeschoolers, a lot of public school students. So at this point, our family has provided award-winning curricula and books for about 100,000 students. A lot of them homeschools, and they're also used as supplicants in the public schools. So I started at the university teaching 300 students a year for freshman chemistry, and then had this personal experience that led me into a lot of K-12 education. I'm concerned about this. I'm sure we share the same attitude toward children.
Mm-hmm.
He has taught through the whole thing. You know, when I went to school, the public schools, which have been, well, when he was starting out, I was in a different state, Houston, Texas. American schools were the best in the world, bar none. Academically, our test scores for Americans on average were terrific, and that's changed a lot over the last 40 or 50 years, and now our average is pretty poor, even though we still have some good schools. So in thinking about the country's problems, I've been especially interested in this because of my interest in education. And I was especially interested in the Washington, D.C. schools. Because under the Constitution, the only schools that Congress really should control are those in D.C. The 10th Amendment leaves the others to the state and the people. But in D.C., here we have some of the worst schools in the country. A large number of those kids never even learn to read. 40% don't graduate, and those that do, the Wall Street Journal reports, they read at a fifth grade level. And they're mostly minority students, 67%.
Oh, African-American.
67% African-American, 17% Hispanic, and some other minority. So here we have these congressmen all parading around in Washington, acting big, and yet in the streets that they walk through to go to school, to work every day, there are 50,000 students being miseducated in a worse way than almost any other school system in our country.
Mm-hmm.
And so I thought that should start there, and I've been making proposals about what Congress should do about that. Now, they have the power structure. He was talking about the money. My opponent in the election, for example, votes against improving those schools because he votes with the unions. There's a lot of power in the unions, and the unions help him get reelected. But so I've been talking about those schools, and I think, for one thing, and he mentioned this in several ways, talking about the difficulties of the money and power and so forth, I have more confidence in the teachers than I do in the rest of them. I remember my uncle and my mother were both public school teachers. My uncle came back from World War II and taught a full load of classes in Iowa in the public schools, and they gave him a few bucks extra to be superintendent of schools.
Mm-hmm.
And those farmers wanted teachers. And I'm listening to him, and I'd be delighted if the entire school board were teachers of this experience. I think the teachers, as he pointed out, teachers are people, and some of them are good and some of them are poor. But I think they could do a lot better job than a lot of the non-teachers that have gained money and power over our schools. And as the money, think about this, in D.C., they spend $450,000 per year on every 30-student classroom for 9 months. Now, if you gave that kind of money to a great teacher, imagine what she could do, and she still have money left over. In Portland, I think it's about $360,000. Across the nation, it's about $300,000. But here's this money, and even at $300,000, the national average, if you give a great teacher $300,000 cash, 30 students in 9 months, imagine what she could do with it. So what's going on? And I think it's clear at least half that money is going other places that aren't necessarily education. I only saw when I was growing up great teachers, you know, public school teachers, and we got a terrific education in the public school. My whole life depends on it. I got to go to Caltech because I got a great high school education, an undergraduate education, a K-12 education. So we need to return to a time when our students are getting superb K-12 educations. And we also, you talk about vocational education, that was part of it. I mean, I was a top science student, but I was taking shop and mechanical drawing and all these things, which were also practical. It's a delight. I didn't know this man before we talked. It's a delight to see him because here's a man with 40 years of experience in education. That's the kind of guy that should be on the school board, in my opinion. All seven of them should be. I don't see any balance necessary. We need great teachers teaching our kids. And in general, it's a generalization, in general, I think all the money that we put into education should go straight to the teachers in classrooms and let them sort it out. Mm-hmm. In every area, our world has been bureaucratized. Mm-hmm. When I started in science, I was fortunate to work with outstanding people and did a lot of interesting things in science. But when I started at the university as a professor, we did our own ordering. We had one bureaucrat down at the office in chemistry who kept track and got suppliers all paid. But now these universities have giant bureaucracies that have raised the cost of teaching so high that the students can't even work their way through college. Mm-hmm. So I like getting rid of the bureaucrats and the hangers-on, the non-teachers, and letting the teachers run things. And even as he points out that teachers are people, some are good teachers, some are poor teachers, and so forth, I have a lot more confidence in people that have taken their lives, devoted their lives to students, teaching them, mm-hmm. than I do to the miscreants who have misdirected so much of the resources from our schools and are responsible for the fact that we no longer have the best schools in the world.
Tell what we'll do now.
Well, can I comment on that?
Yeah, let him comment.
First of all, there's a couple things that I kind of disagree a little bit,
yeah.
And this isn't a debate, this is putting in our
eyes. Right, it should be a debate.
Basically,
go ahead.
Basically, if you take the NAEP test, which is the one that's all over, mm-hmm. even though we have a lot harder group of kids to educate, and part of that reason is the language now, because mm-hmm. We have so many children that now in our schools that don't do English, that the United States still basically is about where it always was. It's always been about the same place in relation to other schools, and in the testing, at least in the NAEP testing, which is the one that tests all over. It hasn't changed, and people think it has, but there is what part of the problem is, and what Art here is saying, and it's you have schools that are really terrific in public schools, and you have ones that are really not very good.
What about the terrific ones? Who's available?
A lot of it has had to do, and this is the problem, one of the problems in our country, a lot of it has to do with the economics of the community.
Mm-hmm.
And you can go to one school, and kids come in motivated, ready to go, and I've been in those schools. Mm-hmm. I've been in. You can go to another school and the kids don't come in motivated and they're struggling with all sorts of problems in their lives that are much harder to educate. And so, but the thing that happens often is the school that is a little higher economics, mm-hmm. then they get the parents pushing on things and supporting and so forth, which makes their school even better yet. where you have schools that are in lower economic areas often don't have, parents just don't have the time to, and the background education maybe even, to really come in and change everything and make it all work. And those schools struggle. And one of the problems we have in Portland, because people will compare Portland to Beaverton, Portland, one of the problems is that we have pretty disparate neighborhoods in Portland. And so we struggle in some schools, and other ones were wonderful. And so you just, that's a problem that isn't directed. Now, one of the problems in Washington, D.C., of course, is that they're a pretty poor area. And they were kind of the first. Michelle Rhee was the superintendent. There was one of the first people who were really pushing a lot of the supposed wonderful reform movement. They were not, she was not well accepted, nor were that with the teachers' unions. Teachers' unions are kind of like everything else. You've got really great ones. We have a fabulous one in Portland. We have maybe one of the best teachers' unions in the country. Seriously, it's the best I've ever seen in the 40 years I taught. Wonderful teachers' union, wonderful people, care about kids, got kids up front, just marvelous people. But you can go to other areas and the teachers are kind of self-centered on their own stuff, not so much oriented towards children. So it depends. But in general, the teachers' unions pretty well represent the teachers generally. And so I just kind of defend them. Sometimes they don't take a strong enough stand themselves on things that they should, like anti-reform movements or the Common Core and how we put it in and shoved it down everybody's throat instead of doing it intelligently.
Like you said, the economics plays a major role.
It's the ballgame.
However, the folks in the high economic area, in all due respect, they understand the value of an education. Mm-hmm. So therefore, they can share that in many ways.
Yeah, I don't know. You can't generalize totally, but all you got to do is look at the testing and look at the economics, and that lines up.
Yeah, but my point is that those folks who are not, who they don't have the background, if you will, to be able to share why you need to be here to get in there and get in those books. Mm-hmm. So they're dependent upon government, if you will, to make darn sure that happens.
It's my job and our job in the school board to make sure that those schools that are lower economic are just as good, and the children just as good education as other schools where you're getting the support. That's absolutely no question about it.
But I see you as the only fighter.
Well, sometimes I think there's other fighters on
that, too. Sometimes it's a question of expectations, too. You expect things. I had an experience one night in La Jolla. I was teaching 300 students freshman chemistry, and I had a whole mix of it, but they're all science and engineering majors, so they had to learn chemistry. I'm sitting eating hamburgers with grad students downtown, and a guy comes in. He's a African-American man. We had a third college. They started the third college at UCSD, which was devoted entirely to minority students. Mm-hmm. So he sits down, and he starts talking politics. Boy, our politics were different. This was black power, third world politics. But then we went over to education, and I said, you know, my course, I do the normal things, and I also go to the lecture hall every night for weekday nights, and I stay till nobody has any more questions. And of my 300 students, about 50 come, and we have a three-hour tutorial every. I do anything I can to help these kids, but they got to learn chemistry. If they don't learn chemistry, they're not going to pass. This guy looks at me and he says, "You're right." He says, "I know because I'm tutoring two students in your course, and your course is tough." But he says, "You're right." He says, "Our worst enemies are the white liberals that come over to the third college and teach watered-down classes to our students and turn them into permanent second-class citizens." Mm-hmm. In that case, and it was happening in the university, student would come in without too good a preparation, and often from these poor, you know, districts and so on. So they had poor expectations. They just teach them watered-down courses and shove them out and say, "Hey, we taught them too." The expectations are different. My feeling, and I can't tell you, I didn't teach in Washington, D.C., but I'll bet you that every one of the kids on the street can learn beautifully if you give them the right tools. Hmm. We have a lot of minority students who use our curriculum, and I talk to a lot of those mothers, and I'll tell you, they've got fire in their eyes. Their sons are not going to live in the streets without an education. And I think if you could provide with the right expectations and the right things, those 50,000 kids in Washington, D.C. could excel. I don't think we should say, well, they're poor. I'm not criticizing him. I don't think we should say, well, the situation is we just have to do the best we can with them, because that's not right. After the Civil War, Booker T. Washington and George Washington Carver created Tuskegee University. And those people that they had to educate came from a very difficult environment. They preached excellence, and they did a terrific job. You don't have to say, this is a poor area, so we can't do as well. I'm not criticizing him. I know what
he
means.
No, because what I'm saying is you need to try as hard as you can. Yeah. You need to do your best in both areas. And a lot of times we haven't made sure that that has taken place.
Exactly.
One of the key things that I'm trying to do on the school board is to make sure that every kid gets an education, regardless.
Chance. Absolutely. But you know, we do have a
equal chance.
And I've never seen a parent. I've never talked to a parent who didn't want their kid to get education.
Exactly. Right.
They all want the kid to get.
Exactly.
I never talked to his. There's parents I've talked to who don't know how to go about it, maybe, but they all want their kid to get
that's
a good education.
Right.
And our job is to give them a good education, regardless of the background of the child, regardless of where the school is, regardless of the zip code, regardless of anything.
So
and
who's
that's our job.
And isn't that mostly true of the teachers, too? They want their students to do best.
They want them
who's
to do that. Some, they,
the
some don't know.
Huh? Who's faltering on the job?
Well, to some degree, it is a faltering from it's the central, it's the United States government and the Oregon Department of Education. To some degree, they're faltering a lot because the push that they've got is not the push that you should have.
Yeah.
But everybody's faltering.
When you say everybody, what do you mean?
I mean, everybody in the school board, including me, is faltering. The parents are faltering. The teachers are faltering.
The parents say, I just want my kid educated, and I'm paying for it.
Yes, but to some degree, how they approach the school is they may not falter. We have teachers. Every teacher falters. You know, you have certain limits. Everybody is faltering. It's kind of all you can do is kind of, in my opinion, is work as hard as you can. Basically, or do as well as you can to make things better and how you go about doing that. It might be a teacher may be standing up for the kids and what the situation is in their school, or maybe they don't, and then the faltering is that they don't, or maybe the principal makes it difficult for teachers to do that, or maybe the principal makes it difficult for parents to be involved. Everybody to some degree is faltering, but there are certain things that we're faltering worse on, and one of the main things that we're faltering on is that we're not really focusing and making sure that all children have those equal opportunities. We're just not. When I taught, and we've talked about this in this show before, when I talked up in Evergreen, we had full athletic programs in the middle grades. Full athletic programs. We had football, basketball, baseball, I don't think I had baseball, but they had wrestling and track and on and on and on, which engaged those kids in the middle school. Portland, we are beginning to put some in. We made some strides, but we're so far from that. So are they getting an equal education? We had a huge music program when I was up in Covington in the middle school. I mean, half 1,000 kids school, 500 of them involved in the music program. We had a marching band. We had all that stuff, which you and I have talked about many times. Mm-hmm. But we don't have that in Portland. You might get it if you're in a certain school.
Okay, right,
we
right,
got
right.
other schools that don't.
And
economics. And so maybe they've raised a couple hundred thousand and put into something like that until you get it there.
But now they're reacting. Now we're in an environment. Now they're reacting with ballot measure number 97.
Well, 97, I like it.
I need more money to put into the schools.
They do. I do need more. I'll be real honest. I do need more money. I'll tell you where I need it. I need it to put in those programs. I need it to do, particularly to get those special reading teachers. That we laid off 72 special reading teachers in the middle of 10 years ago or so, and we put about 6 of them back.
You need to look at those administrators. Those non-teachers.
Yes, but you have to have people to actually get stuff done, you know, that we're doing the stuff with the lead. You need to have people who will go out and take care of the lead problem, who can put together the school bond.
You know, we've been arguing this for a long time.
Yeah.
The point is that we brought up the issue of lead to get rid of the damn administrators. I hate to get into that language aspect of it, remember? Brought the issue up, and we talked about it on this, and had not this guy named Broussard jumped up there and pointed some finger at an administrator and said they need
to
be fired.
Well, that wasn't for the lead. That was really for the, we ended up testing the kids who needed the testing, and that was, you were really helpful on that.
Yeah, but my point is that they should have been doing that a long time ago.
Well, yeah, but
when the custodian fight aspect, the custodians that were fired were doing the right
absolutely.
Thing, and then the school board fired the custodians.
That's right.
All of a sudden, the kids exactly. were getting poisoned.
Exactly what happened.
And that's
exactly what happened.
I fought that issue.
That was the old style. The old. We weren't going to take care of the problem attitude because we're not going to recognize the problem. It's a smooth over. We are not. We're taking care of the lead.
Yeah, but you're the only one.
The school board's taking care of the lead. We got them going forward.
You're the only one that I know, and I'm very familiar with the school board members. They're on the background.
Well, what I'm saying is that we're actually beginning to address the problems, and we don't really have enough.
I know Paul Anthony is kind of.
We don't have enough people right now. Because we got all these missing people to address the problems in the way that we need. There's things we need to be doing that we can't do because we don't have people to get it done right now. And we're rehiring those people, but it's a problem. It's a problem.
Okay, I'm gonna bring Art back up in the deal because he and I talked about another. I'm asking him for a solution because again, he's a rightful guy. He's bringing something to the table. He happened to be running somewhere else, but i.e. in government out there. But anyway, he made mention something about, I'm going to ask you the question. What do you think about that, D.C.? You got any ideas in terms of how you would get those congressmen involved in the issue in D.C.?
Well, I'd simply say, you're running the United States government in a city where 50,000 kids are being shortchanged in the schools.
Right.
And that should be, a top priority for these guys. I think they need to get into those schools, take them over, get the very best teachers in there, develop, get rid of this nonsense curriculums. He's mentioned to them a little bit. I think it should be a top priority. The D.C. schools, since they're the only ones constitutionally these guys should be playing with, should be an example for the nation. And to and we can talk about all the ways to do this. I think I have more confidence in the teachers than I do in the bureaucrats that are telling them, making them miserable. But I think that should be a top priority of the United States Congress. That's what they're allowed to do constitutionally.
Okay.
Those kids are being shortchanged, and they're right there in the same town. They pass them on the streets.
Okay.
And if Congress can't do that, why in the heck are they sending programs out to Oregon and force them down the throats of the educators out here? If they can't run the D.C. schools and give those 50,000 kids a terrific education, we sure don't have to be listening to federal programs that are even of questionable constitutionality being forced all over the country with their money. Okay. Now, if there's money going into the federal government, the education is paid for by local, state, federal taxes. They can send the money out to Oregon with no strings and let these men use it.
Yeah, they used to do that, right?
Yeah,
that was a Title I program. Programs used to do
With
a problem send it out without the strings.
Yes, and with a problem that's this serious, you don't go in there and start nickel and diming and saying, you know, let's cut down the cost. I think it's probably costing us too much, but that's just an opinion. All that money should be available, and it should be available across the board so that every student gets an equal opportunity and the system is created. And there's only one school system in this country that's constitutionally absolutely the responsibility of the U.S. Congress. And if they can't teach those 50,000 kids right, they should just send the rest of the money out to the states and get the hell out of the way.
So what kind of a model would you present to them, being you got them all in a contained environment aspect of it, and say, look, we're going to do something with this D.C. environment that we're responsible for, and this is how this is the solution to that particular problem.
Well,
you have an idea?
I proposed a kind of model the other day in something I wrote, but basically, during a 3-month summer vacation, they ought to sweep in there with the best educators in the country, get all the deadwood out of the way, and do everything they can for those schools. And they should do it fast, and they should improve them as rapidly as possible, because there's two things going on here. One is that we have the problem. The second is that everybody thinks, well, we gradually fix this thing, they'll get better. D.C. schools have gotten a little better because of programs that the Congress has put in, but the point is, you don't say we're going to write off the students that are in there now, but it'll be better 10 years from now. I think that the situation is so ridiculous that in the capital city they have this mess that Congress should devote, I think a lot of them should pay their total attention to it until they fix it. Mm-hmm. Education is a key to the success of our country. And these guys march around in these fancy suits and ties all the time and smile and play congressmen when they're disadvantaged students not getting the advantages of a decent K through 12 education. I think they should deal with it immediately as fast as possible. I don't believe that they should gradually try to improve them so two generations down the kids are going to get a decent education. So I've proposed a little way. But the proposal is just one. The main aspect of the proposal is you fix this problem now. You spend whatever it takes, you get the best educators, and you make at least those schools shine. If you can't, just start passing the money to the states and get the heck out of education. That's my opinion.
Well, what's the oversight that Congress actually has? Well,
they have total oversight, but here's what they do.
I don't know how they do it.
I debated DeFazio the other day. I'll tell you exactly what they've done, or what he does. He says to,
who's in charge of
schools?
Who's in charge?
You know what he said? He says, well, we turn it over to the mayor of D.C. If you want better schools, go talk to the mayor.
Well, that's baloney.
And it wasn't true, because after that time, Congress did pass three bills to try to improve those schools. So I said, Mr. DeFazio seems to think he can change the Constitution. But what he said was, and this is a way out, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, we gave more power to the mayor. The mayor of D.C. is responsible, not us. I'm sorry, it's their responsibility, and they don't have any business saying, well, the mayor's doing it. He was even joking. He says, you ought to get on the mayor's committee if you're interested in education in D.C.
That's funny.
That's what this politician said. And that's crazy. I think he'd agree. We're both in education in different ways.
I'd agree that Congress and you're running that school system.
If those guys go about their business every day with 50,000 kids circulating in that city, and minorities, they love to talk about minorities, don't they? And they're getting a poor education. They ought to fix it or get out of the way.
Well, the Department of Education in the federal government is an absolute total mess.
Absolutely.
Has been for some time. All the stuff, and I'm a Democrat, good supporter of
it should be a
Obama,
pass-through for money,
obviously,
and that's
voting
it.
For Clinton.
Well, it's about the issue, Steve.
But what I'm saying is that's been this major failure of the federal government.
You're absolutely right.
It's been one of the big major failures, and they put the wrong people in. Arne Duncan was not a good guy to be doing that, and we've ended up, and it's made it worse, not better. They used to send you money, and you could take that and put it where you wanted and do something where you needed it, mm-hmm. the Title I money. They still do it, but now the money comes with restrictions. For a long time, they had the race to the top. They'll put a restriction on you have to do this, put in to get the money. It's not the way that works, and it's also not the way that it's set up. One of the things I know Art would probably agree with me is that Common Core is a national curriculum. I'm sorry, they can say whatever they want. and both the far left, I mean, I'm pretty, you know, the stuff I do with, or I've done as one of the founding members of Oregon Save Our Schools, which is a pretty liberal organization, mm-hmm. we absolutely decry the way decry the way that the Common Core has been implemented, and the far right does too. That's the one place we're really come together. We come together also in other places, the far left, which is local control of education.
Yes,
but the truth is that the Common Core, people keep saying, well, it's not a curriculum. Yes, it is. I'm sorry, because it lists what you're to teach.
Local
That's
control.
What the curriculum does.
I've been preaching local control.
Look it up, folks.
For several elections.
And it's crazy.
I don't want to scare this guy,
but you know something? He reminds me of a man. Now, I think their politics are different, but I have a close friend, Ron Paul. He looks like him. He talks like him.
We know, but you're
different. Well, but the problem is, Paul's devoted his life to a different approach, but you have people who for 40 years have done their very best with actually the same motives, but different conclusions. And actually, if you start talking to Americans, whether Democrats or Republicans or whatever, you know, I accidentally wound up chairman of the Republican Party in this state, and I don't have much more time for them than I do the other guys. But the fact is that most people who think want about the same things. We have different ideas about how to achieve them, and we're having so much trouble achieving them that the people on the right and the left and everywhere else are fed up. And it's causing a rather entertaining political problem.
One of the things that has taken place in the federal government that's really is the money.
Yeah.
There were a lot of companies that looked and went, whoa, we could be getting a lot of money out of education. There's a lot of money in education.
Yeah, yes, that's right.
You know, we have a $500 million budget in Portland.
Yes,
so
and
so there's money
for
there.
More.
There's yes, and crying for more.
And not producing.
And yeah, but we're trying. But you have people who want a piece of that money, and those people have gotten that money instead of at the expense of children.
That's right.
We do some of that ourselves. We had
tell the parents what you just said.
Well, I'm just saying that a lot of people want a piece of that money. Education money,
with the kids.
And at the expense of the children.
That's
they don't really care.
Right.
They say they do. That's, you know, nobody's going to say, hey, I'm not for education. I don't like it. They're not going to do that. But they do. But they are getting that money at the expense of children. We do some of that.
Right.
In Portland Public Schools. I've tried to get to get rid of. We paid. We had somebody come in and did 6 hours of training, and we paid him $6,000. Now, we don't have much of that, I got us to give $6,000 to. We couldn't find any money for library books, so I got us to do $6,000 for each out of each principal's budget for library books. I figured we'd spent millions of dollars out of the principal's budgets, and about 0.03% went to library materials and books, and our libraries were horrible. And in a middle school and in a grade school, library is a critical thing. That's you got to have those books to get the kids reading, and so. People were really mad because I said, no, you can. I got a resolution through the school board that said you have to spend $6,000 in your library. The principal's really upset because it's taking their money that they had as their budget. But I'm going, okay, had you spent any money here? Mm-hmm. And it's not that they're, we have wonderful principals. A lot of them are marvelous. We're kind of working on some that we've got. We've actually had some that have left, which should have. But we're working on that hard. But the idea that you would let your library deteriorate and spend this money in $6,000 for 6 hours of training, it doesn't make sense. So not everybody has it together on that kind of stuff. We're doing better.
The first thing you mentioned, we call that corporatism on our side. That's what it is. And these companies...
And my point is, that's what has been the poisoning of the federal government, and it's now the poisoning of our government, Measure 98. You look at it carefully, what's it do? It moves money out of our budget in Portland, and it puts it over into the ODE to spend. Well, I sat there at those Oregon Educational Investment Board meetings. You know, we talked about it for 3 years. I went basically to everyone. Missed two, I think, but I basically everyone. And so did a couple good friends of mine who'd had 30, 40 years in education themselves. And we sat and watched, and it was unbelievable. The last thing they did, just before they disbanded, I'm taking a little credit for the disbanding, by the way, they were going to move $650 million, which is about $50 million in Portland. They were going to move it out to basically Kitzhopper's friends and out into other places controlled by, so they're going to take $50 million of Portland's and give it out into grants and other things.
Yep.
And they didn't get it through the legislature, because the legislature saw through it, but they actually, it was there. I sat at the meeting and saw, and they talked about what they were going to do. It's $50 million out of Portland. We were going to give it to them to go out. We had no idea where it was going. It was into these thing and this thing and that thing.
But many school districts do that in a small way, too.
Well, yeah, we do some of it. Not as much as people think, but we do some of it. Cleaning some of it up.
You know, one thing I want to go, we got about another 4 or 5 minutes. And that is that you talked about D.C. I'm thinking, when I think about D.C. and I think about and the point he made about the superintendent that they brought in, and they ran her out because she was saying, hey, look, we're going to do this, we're going to do this. And the unions ran her out.
Well, with good reason.
No, but they ran out.
Yes, which was a good thing to do. Which is a good thing to do. I don't know if it's the unions, but she is bad news.
My point is that it went right back to the same situation. I was excited about some of the things I was looking at, 60 Minutes and other things about she was doing this.
Yeah, well, a lot of that was
putting pressure on her like it was going out of style.
Yeah, well, a lot of the stuff she was doing was, and for a good reason. That's what I'm saying.
So that's going to be another area that if, in fact, you get to the table.
When there's an important job not being done, fire the people that aren't doing it and get somebody who will.
That's right.
The country, in my opinion, is full of dedicated, terrific educators.
Right,
I think there are a lot of them, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of them. And going back to D.C., those schools are failing. Fire those jerks and get some good people. And I don't think you'd be firing mostly teachers. I think you'd find most of the teachers are dedicated people. Mm-hmm. But it's failing. And if you're in business and you have to respond, if somebody can't do the job, you fire him. Mm-hmm. Get somebody who can. Mm-hmm. And if the system's not working, you fire that and get something that can. Mm-hmm. But you don't abandon 50,000 kids, they totally abandon them, but you leave them in the clutches of something that is disadvantaging them for life because a big portion of them never even learned to read effectively. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure he totally agrees. He might approach it differently, but that's got to be fixed. Mm-hmm. And it's got to be fixed now.
And we have a fairly large number of kids in Portland who are not learning to read well.
Yeah, and you're fighting to improve that. At least you're trying to find books.
In fact, we actually have a new guy who's in charge of the curriculum and so forth, called the Office of Teaching and Learning, who's very good. A guy by the name of Chris Rousseau, and he's very good, and he's really attacking that problem in a pretty sensible way, from my perspective, in a very sensible way. But we only did it in 10 schools to begin with because that was the money that we had.
Well, look, gentlemen, we're about 2 minutes out of the deal here now, and I got to go back to the voting public, like myself, and I'm the lay person, I represent that aspect of it, and I'm looking at results, and in all due respect, that's what you need to do during this election period. Find out what do they bring to the table in this arena. That's a very important piece. It just so happened both of these guys are going to be running, they're running for office now. Steve's running for the school board.
Not to the spring, but I mean, I'm running.
You're running.
You're already in the middle.
How often do you have to be reelected? What's the 4 years?
And then Art is running, i.e., for Congress and right up front with it. That's the government. That's the one who's got that big purse ring. And again, if you notice his background, again, is comparable, as far as I'm concerned, to Steve. They bring something to the table. They've had exposure and they've had results, and that's a very, very important piece. So I would say to the voting public, that's what you need to do. Those are the kinds of people you need to be looking for, because in all due respect, many of us don't have the background to be able to articulate what our real needs are. So we're dependent upon the representation that we're getting, whether it be on a school board or whether it be in Congress. So it's a very important piece that you understand what we're saying here tonight and what I'm saying here tonight, that you've got to be very serious about this thing. There's a lot of things that are out there. So watch what you read, and whatever you get, make sure you ask the person who's running for office to represent you in any capacity. What do they bring to the table? Gentlemen, it's been great. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bruce.
Appreciate it very much. And thank you.
It's a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you very much. It's really good. Thanks again, buddy. Appreciate it.
Welcome back to the Independent Producers Organization Live Showcase. Always have to get that in.
There you go.
And I'm going to turn it over to Bruce so you can introduce your guest.
Thanks very much, Richard. By the way, how are the producers doing nowadays? Everybody doing okay on the circuit? Did you know?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay. All right.
Boy, it's some of these other outfits,
yeah,
like Vancouver, yes, and Tualatin Valley, that we have problems with.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. They don't know how to serve the producers like this place.
Ah, well, you know, this we got place, the best in town. You know,
that's,
I
mean, right.
That's what we're, that's all right, about, right? In fact, that's why we're going to be doing this particular show, because right up front with you, this particular place is very much involved in the whole issue of this election cycle that we're into. This is a very critical, we're in a crisis for that matter.
They probably would be.
You know what I'm saying? We're in a crisis situation, and we got to make sure that the public understands that we are in a crisis, and that the definition of your vote this time around, we need to bring people in government that are bringing something to the table.
It says bringing more people are registered to vote, yes, than ever.
Yes, so, oh, very much so.
Good.
But sometimes we got to make sure. Some of them are in a personal situation. Maybe they may be looking at the presidential race aspect of it, and they're just talking about personal issues in many ways. But the point of the matter is that it's a golden opportunity. Again, I'm talking to you, the public folks, who, whether you got pro or con on either side, the point of the matter is we got our youth. In fact, we just did a show not too long ago with one of the people that's sitting here with right now, with Art and Steve Buel, and we talked about why the format and what you should be looking for and how you should vote. And then you should ask that question of any candidate running for whatever office: what do you bring to the table for the office that you're running to? Very much so. Get the politicians out, because in all due respect, before we got into the election, the public was crying and said, we could care less about these Congress people. Get these politicians out of our way. Get them out, okay, of our way. We need some very responsible people there. But guess what? Mass media, you know, they were basically running the whole deal at first 10%, and they're fighting back and forth between CNN and Fox and this, that, and the other. But the bottom line, now we're in the majority. Now the people, the ones who are in need, if you will, of their education for their kid, jobs, I mean, on and on and on, the family, I mean, you can just go on and on and on, but the bottom line, you gotta eat. You know, if you can't get a job, you can't eat in this country.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Trust me, otherwise. So anyway, but the bottom line is, and I'm sharing this with you, that we're continuing that, and we're the only outfit that's kind of like doing that. We do more politics than politics. I'm talking about issues. We're a very issue-oriented facility over here at Portland Cable Media.
Right.
Very good, very good people. So with that, we're going to do basically something similar tonight.
Okay.
I brought Art back because I would love to have had the other person that was running in District 4 for Congress, and that was Peter DeFazio. Then I could have had a similar kind of situation that we had the other day in education, because Art had education. Now I brought Steve Buel here, and we talked about education. I thought it was a good show. It was a very responsible, okay, show aspect of it. So this time around, we don't have him here. So we got me and you. We're the voters aspect,
right,
of it. But we do have Art, and he does bring something to the table. And in this particular segment, we're going to talk about some of the work that he's doing that is somewhat universal, okay, and that helps people. I mean, everybody's talking about the whole issue, in all due respect, of Obamacare, and we got pros and cons and this, that, and the other. But at the end of the day, you know what I mean, it's very costly and whatever, but at the end of the day, are people getting well? and well, what does that mean, if you will? And I'm not going to get all into what Art does, basically, but that's what he is. He's a scientist, and he's doing something. He's been doing something for years along this particular line, and it's going to benefit Americans across the board.
Okay.
And so what we're going to do, we're going to give Art the opportunity to talk about that. And talk about that across the board and some of the other activities that he's been involved from his work ethics aspect of it. So in essence, what does he bring to the table, right? And this,
right,
is, he's running, but what he brings to the table, which I think would be very, very beneficial for these United States. But he just so happened to be running. He in Oregon, he's Oregon grown.
Okay.
Oregon born. Okay, right on.
No, actually, I'm not. I've been here 35 years.
No, but we just
a refugee from California.
Oh, yeah, no, but we're taking that away. No. You've got a whole new birth certificate. That's a big thing.
Okay.
It's a good idea. When I was a kid, my parents moved to Texas.
Yes.
and the kids on the playground called me a Yankee. Uh-oh. I was in trouble. Oh, but then we moved from Houston to Victoria, yes. And the kids on the playground, I told them I was from Houston. And I was just, then I was
no,
fine.
No problem, right?
Okay. So we've been in California, in Oregon, 35 years.
Good. Okay, Art, let's talk about yourself, basically. Let's talk about what you, the kind of work, and because I know that's one of your main staples, if you will, yeah. As far as your platform is concerned.
Well,
what do you do?
In as a profession, I've been mostly an educator and a scientist. I taught college students, undergraduates, graduates, and postdoctoral students at UC San Diego and Stanford. And then I've spent quite a lot of my time in K-12 education.
You did a
program on that. But in science, I've worked
and
largely.
Before you leave there for the benefit of the deal, and you're still doing that, Nia.
Oh, yeah,
just
so,
make
yes,
mention about
yeah.
the fact that's another piece of
we
business.
We still have, right. We have about 60,000 students that we provide curriculum and books for.
Okay.
But in science, I've worked largely in biochemistry and in medicine. In biochemistry, our expertise is in little clocks that are built into the protein molecules, which make up virtually everything that all we are is a big collection of tens of thousands of specialized proteins that give us life.
What's that? Anything like DNA or?
No, DNA is the instruction set on how to build proteins.
Okay.
And we're specialists in a little molecular clocks that are built into the proteins, and once they're synthesized, they change with time. And those timers have biological effects and biological uses. It's a specialty of biochemistry.
Hmm.
But I decided when I was a young scientist that I'd spend half my time having fun, which is the biochemistry, mm-hmm. and half my time working in medicine. And Linus Pauling and I worked together for a long time in both areas. But one of the things we did in the late 60s is to invent a field called metabolic profiling. And it's a method of quantitatively measuring human health. Now, you would think of it as diagnostic medicine. You detect a disease. But there are much more powerful things to do than are done by doctors today.
Mm.
And if you go to the doctor, he may measure half a dozen things, chemicals in your urine, and maybe 30 parameters in your blood. But we started out in the 60s measuring about 150 things in blood and in urine and breath,
yeah, okay.
And then have expanded down to where we measure about 2,000.
Oh, wow.
We don't, the human biochemistry.
2,000 a little clock?
2,000 chemical substances.
Okay, because I mean,
when we started this work, we built a laboratory which was capable of quantitative analysis of about 150 things in, say, a urine sample or a breath sample.
Mm-hmm.
And then we would measure these things and look for statistical patterns that were characteristic of things we would like to know about the person, whether he's ill, whether he's going to become ill, the effects of therapy on an illness, this kind of thing. And we found nice patterns for breast cancer, multiple sclerosis, muscular really? Dystrophy. Actually, every health issue we looked at, we could find a pattern characteristic of it. There was only one pattern we failed. The only experiment we ever failed in is we couldn't use a urine to predict the GPA of a Stanford student. But other than that, it worked pretty well. But the tools we used in those days were very laborious. We had to build a specialized laboratory. It took 5 years to build it, and we could do wonderful things, but only slowly and expensively. We could prove that measuring a large number of things in urine, breath, saliva, and then doing statistical pattern recognition on them could do a lot,
mm-hmm.
but the tools of measurement were so slow and expensive that it was a research trick. It did not help people.
Mm. Was this down at Stanford or at the other?
We did this at UCSD and Stanford, and then we did it at a research institute that Paulie and I founded separately.
Okay.
And now we do it at the Oregon Institute of Science and Medicine, which we founded 35 years ago.
And that's your facility.
Yeah. And But now, technology is advanced, and we have machines that can measure 2,000 substances and 10 microliters of urine in a minute. That's a huge amount of information. It isn't understandable. Most of those substances, the biochemistry of a human is so complicated that you can't understand the pattern, but you can look for patterns that are useful. And this technology now has advanced so much to the point that if calibrated, it can make a tremendous difference in people's health. But to calibrate it, you have to have samples from human beings that are useful. For example, we know that there's a pattern for breast cancer. We discovered that in the 70s in the urine. Now we have a much more powerful tool for looking. And what we think is that that pattern is there before the disease is diagnosed. Cancer is a degenerative disease. It develops over a period of years until finally it breaks out into symptoms you can see. Well, we're pretty sure that those patterns, we know those patterns, and that biochemistry is there years before the lady knows she's sick. But to find out, to calibrate the system, you have to have, if you're going to do it with urine, you can do it with breath, blood, we're concentrating on urine now. You have to have urine samples from women who later got breast cancer, because you have to see whether you could have seen it early.
Yeah.
Well, in order to do that, you have to collect samples from the general public. We now have 8,500 volunteers we're working with in Southern Oregon. Half of them are women, or girls, women across the age spectrum. And we collect periodically samples of their urine, store it cryogenically so it can't change, and wait. And we hope none of them will become ill, but we know statistically some of them will. And in the case of breast cancer, after we have 15 or 20 people who had given us samples in the years before they became ill, and then we know they got that disease, we can calibrate the technique to see the disease early. So we have a, it seems like an unusual thing, and a lot has been made about in politics, because I ran for Congress. I'm probably the first congressional candidate that ever asked the voters for a urine sample. We ask, and in our in Southern Oregon, about 8,500 are doing this, and it's valuable because the powerful techniques that can look for these patterns are now developed to the point that they could be offered to people very inexpensively for preventive medicine, and we're collecting urine from normal people, keeping track of their health, and it's not just breast cancer, all sorts of things. The problem is one of quantitating health. If you are ill, suppose you have a disease, you have some other form of cancer, I'm not just concentrating on cancer, any disease, the doctor says, well, try this, it may help you. It would be good if you could see whether it's helping you, rather than waiting to see whether you live or die, or what
makes
it looks like
sense.
3 months from now.
Makes a lot of sense.
With a cheap, fast enough method of measuring the severity of that disease, you can make a graph of yourself weekly. And if you're trying one kind of therapy and it doesn't work, you'll know that it's not working because you have a quantitative way of measuring the disease. So this kind of pattern recognition on large numbers of substances in body fluids is useful for therapy, because there are usually several things you could do and you'd like to know whether it's working so you can switch. And it's useful for advanced diagnosis and, of course, for diagnosis of disease. And then there are other things. For example, there's a very strong, we discovered this in the 70s, very strong pattern for physiological age. We're all aging. We age at different rates depending on our on our genetics. But the magazines are full of things you might do, right? Should you exercise more? My thesis advisor, Martin Kamen, discovered carbon 14. He said he noticed people that exercise live longer by the length of time they were exercising, and so he wouldn't do it. But that's a joke. The question is, will exercise give you a longer life and less disease? What will it do to your physiological age? What will any one of the hundreds, probably thousands of things people say will help you live longer work? Well, that's hard to experiments to do. Suppose somebody said, and I'm not saying this is true, but you see the reader says, take vitamin E, you live longer. Well, fine. If I got real interested in that, I might get a bunch of men to take it and a bunch of men not to take it and follow them for the next 30 years and find out if it helped. My son could do the next experiment. My grandson could do the next experiment. And maybe a couple of centuries from now, we know something. But if you can quantitatively measure physiological age, it's different. Suppose you can measure it to an accuracy of 3 years. If you got 100 men and it decreases by the square root of n, you know the physiological age of 100 men to 3/10 of a year. Then you can follow the physiological aging of a couple of hundred people, men or women, for a while, see what that rate is, and then change one parameter, say one thing they're doing, watch them for another 3 months and see if it works. because you have a way of quantitatively measuring their physiological age, you can now do practical experiments in a few months instead of waiting forever.
Wow.
So what we started, Linus and I started in the late 60s with a concern. We wondered what we could do about optimizing nutrition. What was the optimum nutrition? But we had no way of measuring health quantitatively, so we couldn't tell. And this was the answer to this, working on it in this way. And there are all kinds of things that are of interest. Diet has a tremendous effect on the growth rate of cancer. We found we could vary the growth rate of cancer in mice over a tenfold range by just what we ate, fed them. And these things, measuring these things quantitatively, and that's what scientists do. It's interesting. Medicine's a little different. It grew out of it. It has a different history, and there's some medical science, but it's a mixture of medical science and art, and very valuable, and especially valuable in the hands of a physician with a lifetime of experience. But modern science, with the tools we have, can measure things very quantitatively. When you do that, science can help you a lot to develop better tools. And our thing is measuring thousands of things in breath and urine mainly, and looking for statistical patterns that give useful information to improve and extend people's lives. We say our goal is to increase the quality, quantity, and length of human life. And so we spend half our time doing that. Now we're spending all our time, because the sample bank is such a big undertaking for us, and we're not a very large institution. So I'm running for Congress, and I'm collecting urine from some of the voters. But those are separate activities. I'm a scientist, and that's where our science has led us in an effort to improve medicine.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, again, along that line, folks, this is why I've invited Art here, and you've seen him several times before, because he brings something to the table. And it's very important. And in fact, the thing that you hear about to date in the whole election aspect of it, and when you think about the presidential election, both of them are talking about the same thing.
Mixing science and medicine, however, can have its downside.
My opponent in the race for
Congress, Congressman DeFazio, has ridiculed me for collecting urine, of course.
No.
But of course, that's the way it's done. And you mentioned this earlier. You're talking about the politics. There are extremely important issues before our country in this presidential election. We can't hear about them because these people are busy taking everybody off message and talking about the personalities of people.
Yeah, that's right.
And I'm on the Republican side. And I think the candidate has a lot of great policies that he's interested in, but I don't think most of the voters don't even know that because they're busy throwing rocks at each other over things that don't really matter to us. I don't care what kind of language he uses. I want to know what he can do to help my country.
Let's go back to why you're here. You bring something to the table.
Yeah.
You know? We got two major issues in this country right now. We got a budget, overflowing budget.
Yeah.
Trying to figure out where do we find the money to, if you balance some of this stuff, to maintain, if you will. And then we got the whole issue, and then naturally folks are politically, they're using this Obamacare piece.
Mm-hmm.
Both sides are saying, well, politically, is to say, well, look here, vote for me and I'm going to tear it down. Both sides are saying the same thing. You know, I want to tear it down here, I want to tear it down here. But the bottom line is that they at least brought it to the table to show that there are some problems with the existing one. But we still recognize, from the public standpoint, we got to have some kind of health care. Everybody wants to live a little longer in aspect of it.
That's right.
And then Art, on the other hand, he can bring that to the table. That's what I'm saying, bringing something to the table. Now imagine him being up there talking to all of these guys at the same time. Just what we just went through, they can see some sense now. I can see some of them now say, oh my God, I can run on some of that stuff right off the bat. Because one, I can have an impact on the budget, because now we don't have to do this. We can look at this and spend a little bit more money in this arena, if you will, and then solve some of the problems before they happen.
Yeah, well, you know that thing I told you about trying to get advanced diagnosis for cancer, breast cancer?
Right.
You could actually, even a congressman could understand that in 5 minutes.
I'd love
to get a chance to explain it to him.
Well, that's a good thing.
The economy, you know, is a terrible problem.
Yes.
And it affects politics. I've run for this office before, and every time I've run, I've won all the rural counties in my district. Mm-hmm. But I don't win in Lane County, Eugene and Corvallis, because the universities bring large amounts of money to those communities, and they aren't feeling the effects of all the debt and money printing and overspending that the Congress has practiced. Mm-hmm. They may, because our economy now hangs by a thread. These politicians, including guys like the one I'm running against, these guys have got themselves reelected by taxing, printing, and borrowing so much money that almost every American in his way of life is at risk now because of the terrible economic situation they've created. And we need people from business and industry, people who have actually had the balanced budgets to possibly pull us back from the brink of disaster economically. So the same sort of thing, you know. I don't want career politicians that never earned an honest dollar in their lives. I want people that had to succeed economically, because our country needs to succeed, and in the hands of the career politicians, it's in great danger.
Well, but like you said, you have to run under the format of a politician, but what you bring to the table is the most important piece. And then the public can resonate. Look, I want to have a better life, if you will. You know, I've got a tradition of, let's say, having heart problems or this, that, and the other. And if not a situation, so now imagine the expense that goes along with that if I have no knowledge. But if I had knowledge, and if there was a product that was on the market, if you will, that could maybe counter that to a certain degree, I can relate to that. Yeah. And I'm saying that that's why, and why we're doing the program now, because I want the voting public to understand that that's what you need to look for in, quote, a person who's running for office who happens to be running, yes, run on a political base, one way or the other, either registered Republican, Democrat, Independent, whatever. But my point is that they bring something to the table that you can see your money coming back to you. You got me, lowering the taxes and all that kind of stuff.
You at least accomplish something in life besides tricking people into voting for them.
Exactly. And in fact, now let's just get into that arena. Now, before we leave that particular part, the urine piece. You said you only had a limited amount. How do you go about getting urine? What do you do?
Well, we've done it a couple of ways, by mail and in person. The best way is you have a volunteer who's in your database and is giving sample. And the best way is you call him up and say, tomorrow or when it's convenient for you, I'm going to leave a little super cold container on your porch with a little vial. You put some urine in. It's a little collection device. And I'll pick it up in the evening, sometime during the day. Would you mind putting a few drops of urine in this and putting it back in the container on your porch? Personal contact with them going door to door is more effective than contacting them by mail. So right now we're doing it on a door to door basis, and and that for thousands of people, that's quite an undertaking. But that gets the samples frozen immediately at cryogenic temperatures. Is better for the samples. And the human interaction is such that almost everyone complies. They continue. Whereas if you just mail them stuff, it's some more stuff that came in the mail, and you tend to lose people.
Okay.
So now we go to door to door.
Okay. So now what about the information that are the results you get from your urine? What do you do with that? I mean, is it something that you put on the market or
share it with someone? We calibrate this, we've finished calibrating and show the power of the technique.
Right.
We're scientists. We work, we don't take government money, but we're private individuals support our research. We publish it in the literature, and if it's good enough, industry picks it up and makes a product out of it.
Okay.
We don't make a product out of it. That's a huge undertaking. But mainly we have to show through our science it's worthy of being a product, and then industry would pick it up. You have to also, industry has to deal with all of the political problems that our medical system has.
Very much so.
It even affects our research. It used to be that we could work with a doctor, he'd collect samples, you know, it was a little simpler. Now we can't, because the lawyers have put so many impediments in front of the doctors that it's actually dangerous for a doctor to be involved in the storage of a sample. As long as a sample exists, he has a liability that he can be sued on. And so it used to be that we got most, when we did this in the 70s, big Kaiser Permanente, doctors everywhere, we collaborated with all kinds of physicians.
No problem, and they provided
today, if the sample, if a doctor if he takes the urine sample, measures it, and throws it away, which is what he does in the doctor's office, that's okay, because the sample is stored cryogenically. The lawyers hang him with the responsibility to use the sample in any way that might ever help his patient. So if he's stored from 500, he has a financial and professional obligation to the sample so great that it's impossible for him to fulfill it. But if someone became sick, the lawyer will say, you know, my client might not have gotten so sick if you had thawed that sample out and looked at it again. And so he has a continuing legal obligation to the sample. That's why we're going to individual Americans. I can ask you for a urine sample, and you can give me one, and it's still allowed by our government. But it's not allowed for me to promise to do anything. If you ask me now, if you see anything in my sample that's useful, will you tell me? I have to say no. Because if I said yes, I'd be using a non-approved medical technique to give medical advice, and until the bureaucrats in Washington say this technique can be used and you can give medical advice from it, they'd throw me in prison for doing it.
If you were able to get to the table,
if we could get the thing finished,
you could share it and educate.
Doing it the way we're doing it, and publishing in the open literature, that will advance medicine.
Okay.
Because
that's the key.
Much bigger institutions, we're a small research lab, big institutions, big companies, if they see that as a worthwhile product, they will go through all the hoops in the government required to allow them to deliver it to people.
Okay.
That's the way the system works today, and you have to use the system that's in place.
Wow. Well, look, let's jump into this other area with reference to, well, naturally, like I say, in the political arena that you're running an aspect of it. I mean, you run several times over before. Now, how is the public, in fact, how is the media taking? Are they giving you the opportunity to educate them as to what you bring to the table, and then basically compare that with and ask the same question of,
well, it's kind of an interesting thing, because I'm doing something that isn't normally done.
Okay.
Normally you run for Congress, you fail, or you go do something else.
Mm-hmm.
And we do something else. We do science all the time. That's our main life. But taking our district, for example, the Oregon District 4 is the size of Switzerland and has 350,000 homes. Very hard to deliver a message to them. It's very expensive. And a congressman, the sitting congressman, spends huge amounts of tax money delivering messages, and then by favoring companies, they give him money, favoring special interests, favoring unions. So he has probably $5 or $10 million worth of resources to deliver a message with. A newcomer.
And sending me a flyer.
Well, I'm sending you at my expense his flyer. You know,
right, okay.
It takes a while. So when we first ran, they didn't see us coming. We were actually ahead of this guy for a little while. Then he realized he was in trouble, and he put this whole apparatus on us. He told all kinds of odd stories about us, you know, and ran us down. And so your reputation starts to slip, because they attack you, and you're trying to get a message to the public, but it's hugely expensive.
Mm-hmm.
So you go down, and then you can start coming back up, because if you've run two or three times, your message begins to get through.
Mm-hmm.
We'll do better this time than we have before, because we've had campaigns before where we have partially educated people, partially communicated with them with the resources we have. So I debated this guy the other night, and he said, why are you running again? You lost.
Oh.
And I lost three times, actually. Mm-hmm. And I said, I'll keep running against this guy until he either quits or I win. Because, and the fact is, every time you run, you communicate more. Yes. And a challenger, especially up against a 30-year career politician, has probably a several election job before everyone is educated.
Mm-hmm.
So this time, we're getting a better response. People understand more about what we are. It takes a while.
Mm-hmm.
And the normal paradigm of run quick, and if you don't succeed, go do something, quit. I'm not a quitter. And if we don't quit...
Well, as a scientist, you can't be.
If we don't quit, eventually we'll improve the congressional representation of District 4.
Good.
We'll just stick to it until we do it.
Good.
And the pundits and the media and the politicians kind of look down on this, but actually look down on it because it's very dangerous for them. if we had principal people who have some accomplishments in life running against everyone, you know, the Congress's approval rating is about 10%.
Oh, yeah, very much. That's what I'm saying.
These guys stay in office because of all the perks, all the corporatism, all the sort of unprincipled things they do to win elections. But if in every one of the 435 congressional districts, somebody who's accomplished something in life stuck his head up and said, I'll work on this guy till I beat him, we'd have a good Congress.
It might take
a few terms, and we'd beat him. So we just keep doing it. Mm-hmm. And he has to put up with that, and he doesn't like it very well, because each time a message gets through, more and more, and each time you learn more, because it takes a lot of knowledge. Along the way, I accidentally became chairman of the Republican Party in Oregon for a couple of years. That taught me a lot of things I never wanted to know. But the point is that it's so important. If you decide to do this as a citizen volunteer, and I'm a scientist, I never expected to do anything like this. If you told me a few years ago I'd be in politics, I'd told you you're crazy. But the country's in trouble. During the Cold War, our family worked on civil defense because we were worried about nuclear war. Now we're worried about the politics. So you go in there and find an objective. Our objective is to improve things for District 4, keep working on it until you get a chance. If you do that, most of these career politicians would be out of office. But it's a little different way, seeing that my objective is to improve my congressional district, and I don't mind being whipped a few times before I succeed.
Right. What would you say if I was to say to you that to make application to run for office, you had to not only identify yourself and your background, but also you'd have to respond to the current issues. At the same time, what do you bring to the table to resolve some of those issues? What do you think about that? I think that's a simple...
Tell that to the media. Look what they're doing to our country right now. The guys are so obscured, the issues, you can't even hear them. It's incredible.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, you know, we all have ulterior motives. And when you think about the media aspect of it, the person who may be covering the story aspect of it are not necessarily... The way they get paid is through advertisement. In most cases, the people with the money, that's our capitalist society that we live in. You know, I got to think about my interests. I'm trying to get you to buy something, right? You got me? And I want to make sure those regulations doesn't mess me up so I start not getting my money. So consequently, they get the ads in the paper, right? And guess who they support? A lot of those folks on the corporate side of it, they support their interests. Because when you start thinking about a lobbyist, it's really that company being represented.
Well, and think about this for Congress. The 435 congressmen,
right?
And the country spends about $3 trillion a year.
Right? I know what you're
talking about. So they're 435, 435 million, 435 billion, and I'm not even up to the trillions. Each one of these guys controls about $6 billion in expenditures every year. That's a lot of economic power.
Wow.
You go up against that, right? And that money buys influence. There's some studies have been done on this, and it's about $1 of lobbying buys $300 or $400 of goodies from Congress. That's why we have all these lobbyists.
Wow.
So the money and power is incredible. I like Indiana Jones movies because I'm the same age as Harrison Ford. I figure if he can do those things, I can imagine doing them. But one of those movies, his sidekick says, why are they doing this, Indy? Why? Fortune and glory, kid. Fortune and glory, which is money and power.
Yeah.
The money and power in the hands of these congressmen keeps them in office, even though the public gives them a 10% approval rating and knows that the whole crowd of miscreants should be thrown out. That's what money and power is managing to do. But the people are getting fed up with it, and at least I hope, especially in District 4,
that eventually
these people will say, enough's enough, we'll send this guy packing.
Right.
And that needs to happen in a lot, most congressional districts, if you want to know the truth, in order to improve our government.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, you know, I tell you what, we got about another 20 minutes or so, and this way we can get some good interaction with you, Rich, and get Art involved in this deal. And this is kind of like a saying, okay, fine, let's talk about the election a little bit. Well, what do we feel about, you know what I mean?
Which part?
That's the whole
things that do
we're
with the
be
state?
We're talking about different kinds of parts and just respond to it. So we're gonna respond with the public, and then he's the guy who has to run, so we'll talk about it from that end of it, and then he can come in and hopefully talk about some solutions to that problem.
Measures?
Yeah, you're going to talk, yeah, just talk in it. We can start off with the presidential. You want to do that, and then we'll come down to the state. What do you think about, you know, you've seen it. I mean, you got CNN, the entire media. I mean, gee whiz, I mean, the latest is the sex thing, the tapes, and all that kind of stuff. And
well, doesn't matter. Still want Trump to win.
Okay. Yeah.
That's
okay.
All there is to it.
And why?
Because I think he is more capable.
Okay.
We finally got a businessman coming there that can run things really well.
Okay.
And he is just the right person in time. And I get depressed the way when I see how these things are running. But don't give up. We still have to keep trying to get him in office. And I think he'll just do a great job.
And your issue, you said because he's a businessman, your issue is, what are the issues you think he can resolve as opposed to
he
the
can
other
deal with all aspects of government.
Okay.
Includes, he talks about making America great. Well, that's kind of a thing in itself. Takes a whole lot of effort that way. But all the other issues, dealing with other countries, dealing, and he wants to deal with crime in this country. So yes, he's still, he has a lot to deal with,
mm-hmm.
and I think he's capable of doing it.
Mm-hmm.
I really think he's a perfect person for that position.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
any other one?
No, but do we can talk about local measures, state measures.
Well, let's do the presidential piece. Then we'll come down
to the
state, because we want to give him a feel of what the public is thinking.
Okay.
And that rationale. Then let him respond, because he's a scientist. He's the guy who's going.
Well, Trump's policies are terrific. You never hear about them on the tube because they're talking about something else. But think about this. This man has managed to build skyscrapers in New York City.
Yeah.
Do you know what New York City is like?
New York, buddy.
Do you know what the culture is? He actually has built skyscrapers, mm-hmm. and got them built,
mm-hmm.
and financed them. Now, that doesn't mean everything succeeded. He's had some bank, all these things. You always have fit, but he actually got that done.
Mm-hmm.
A man that can do that can stop the wars, stop the overspending, and improve our country and give us, and really do what his hat says on it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that doesn't mean he's a saint. If he was, he wouldn't have been able to build anything in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
But he's accomplished things. And sure, he's a rough and tumble guy, but that's what's required in a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
We have some very dangerous things in the world today, and this man, I think, could attack them.
Mm-hmm.
And when you see him giving a speech on policy, on a particular issue, whether it's the Second Amendment, or whether it's the wars, or the foreign affairs, very thoughtful and very good.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know he speaks extemporaneously and entertainingly in other ways, but it's clear that he has a pretty good view. He's a patriot. He wants to help his country.
Okay.
I don't care what he did 10 years ago or what he said 15 years ago. Neither do you. You were in the Marine Corps, and I'll bet you that they weren't all saints locker room.
I was a real nice angel.
But the point is that he's accomplished things, and if you look at his policies, which the media is continually covering up with all this nonsense, they're excellent, really excellent. The National Review reviewed them completely in an excellent article. Obviously a very capable man. Nobody walks on water, but compared to the alternative, it's obvious you should vote for Mr. Trump.
Okay. Well, let's put that old equal parts of, there's the other side. Do they bring things to the table? I'm talking about Hillary right now.
Okay.
What does she bring to the table? Since she's been
one thing I can tell you about her is she is pro-choice.
Okay.
That means she is totally.
Okay.
Bill has been, but I always knew way back that you could feel her being pro-choice, and she would never give up on health for women. And
That was it.
That's right. Okay. It's one of her things.
Now, that is a major issue.
It's a major issue. I just told you about my research. I said our goal was to improve the quality, quantity, and length of human life.
Okay.
And that's pro-life.
Right.
And if you can't figure out that the greatest secular gift that any human has is the opportunity to live a human life, and that no one has the right to take an innocent human life, if you can't figure that out, I don't think you can figure much out at all.
Females carry that human life.
And she is hardcore pro-abortion. Mm-hmm.
And then we got the other politics from a Harriet aspect of it is that many within our country are looking at, which is a kind of a transition piece, of a woman president being president of these United States.
Yeah.
Okay. Talk a little bit about that. Do you think that's something that should resonate with all of us?
Maybe. How about
is it important?
Margaret
Thatcher or something?
Thatcher.
No, yeah, Margaret Thatcher. There's a good example. There are as many outstanding women as there are outstanding men. So get an outstanding one. Why get a career politico who has really messed up everything she's tried to do in government? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. That's a poor choice.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I get a whole book that says all these things that she did to screw up. And so, it's hard. But boy, someone like Margaret Thatcher.
Yeah,
I mean that would be a.
But would you say also too that she's been in this business for 40 years? I mean,
right.
What would have happened had she ran, let's say, the first time out?
Because what did she accomplish in those 40 years? Well, name something.
Bill had to leave the way.
He had
to do the whole thing.
Right.
She is just like falling in easy to this opportunity to become president.
Right.
She just fell right into it.
She's had one functional role where she did things on her own, and that is Secretary of State.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And on her watch, she just started several wars. That's mm-hmm. her accomplishment. Mm-hmm. And those wars are not helpful for the people that have been suffering under them. As Secretary of State, she has shown a total failure in foreign policy, and virtually everything she's done has started another war. Mm-hmm. And those wars are not helping our country.
Well, as you know, again, we're living in some of a crisis situation, and when you're running for office, mm-hmm. you know, you use whatever tools you have to deal with it, and you tend to seek out or market to individuals that you feel would resonate to supporting you, right? Whoever runs. Mm-hmm. And we got two candidates in the run of our way. They're in the same boat. Some of her positives are his negatives. Some of his negatives are her positives. You see, I'm just saying in so many words, each are trying to look at it from the standpoint, what is it going to take for me to win?
I don't think Trump does so much, and that's one of the reasons he's in difficulty. He speaks extemporaneously from his... from himself on all these issues, where she is very, sort of manipulative of the situation. You must tell the truth. In science, if you don't tell the truth, nothing works.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It's been remarked, entering politics from mm-hmm. science is about the worst. It's like going to another planet.
Mm-hmm.
Because the truth is quickly a casualty. And it isn't whether you can catch somebody in a little misstatement, that's what they're doing all the time in this business, it's whether they fundamentally are telling you the truth. If you look at his policies, I think that's what he's doing. Mrs. Clinton is simply an ambitious person who wants higher
mm-hmm.
office.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to... Somehow, the media have gone completely wild in this election. We've never seen anything like this before.
Yeah,
all partisan. They've thrown all ideas of journalism to the wind and are foursquare trying to manipulate the people of this country into doing something that's not good for them.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope they fail.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I guess another thing I'll share. We're in a very progressive way. I mean, that's why the public is very upset about the politician.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want to relate to the politician. And as you know, the media today is really that 10%. They tend to represent the majority end of it. Remember, during the primary, it was just CNN and Fox. Mm-hmm. You got me? And then all of a sudden we get into the general election. It's really where the masses are.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, yes.
And Trump was doing the apprenticeship program. Mm-hmm. And guess where he was communicating? Mm-hmm. With the masses. Mm-hmm. So he had his base. And then she had her base with this other end. Mm-hmm. Because you could buy, if you will, the electoral college mm-hmm. in the primary, mm-hmm. but you can't buy them in the general. Mm-hmm. You got to go state by state by state, mm-hmm. and so the advantages he has is that's where that equal piece comes, because you had all these other politicians running, mm-hmm. but they didn't have enough money to buy their electoral college in some ways. But my point is, it's a game. It's a chess game. It's a heavy piece.
Well, right now, it's just a game of trying to tell enough lies about the other candidate to confuse the people.
That's right.
And then the people got to wail over, because the only thing we got to see, the news, with all due respect, is media. Mm. We got mass media, we got CNN, and we got Fox. That's kind of the major piece. And you got I'm just saying, you can go right down the line, and it's the same deal. Mm. It's nothing different. It's not talking about the issues that we're talking about, and that's the subject that was one of the reasons why we got Artie on the table. What do these folks bring to the table? Well, in all due respect, they're trying to save face and keep what they got and not really deal with the issue, because they can't deal with the issue because they don't have the background. Mm-hmm. And their history has been this other thing just to stay in office.
Yeah, and they have odd characteristics. My friend Harrison Schmidt taught me this. He was the last man to land on the surface of the moon. Mm-hmm. He's mm-hmm. a Caltech-trained scientist like I am, but he served in the Senate because he became famous as an astronaut. He told me he was in that building. He was the only guy in there that wanted to solve problems. The politician wants to manipulate the problem to his advantage, but not solve it. We have a problem in District 4 this way. They started taking away access to the forests and destroying our lumber industry. The job of the congressman was to use his power in Congress to prevent that and give our people back access to their natural resource. Mr. DeFazio didn't do that. What he did instead was to get some welfare. He says, well, you lost some of your tax base, we'll get you some money. He didn't get access to the forests, and so our lumber industry has died. The last mill in Josephine County is dead, closed. But he got you some welfare for the counties, payments to the counties. Mm. Now, this is what the politician does. He didn't solve the problem. He benefited. Mm-hmm. Because after that, every 2 years, he could say, better reelect me. You got to get that welfare keep coming. Mm-hmm. Right?
But you see, the people recognize that. Yeah. Right? Oh. But my point, they don't vote that way, though.
I know.
That's the problem. Because once they
same thing with
control,
the veterans, you see. The veterans' issues, if he's turned those to political advantage for 30 years, some problems that can be very easily solved. Mm-hmm. But neither he nor his colleagues in Congress want to solve those problems. They want to keep getting constituent service and giving speeches on the problems to get reelected. And so Harrison said the main characteristic he noticed, and scientists are problem solvers, so it was especially noticeable mm-hmm. to him, was that these career people stay in office by keeping the problems there and politicking on them instead of solving them. Mm-hmm. And a scientist solves problems, an engineer solves problems, a businessman solves problems, a politician just perpetuates the problem but gets on the side of it that will get him more votes. Mm-hmm. That's a huge difference, mm-hmm. and that's one of the reasons we have these people still in office.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, you're right, we can go on and on and on. In fact, I'm a good example. I've run for office in this town for a number of years. I've run for governor, I've run for Congress, I've run the whole nine yards. But when I ran, I had solutions to issues. Yeah. I mean, I brought something to the table. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, they would interview me and this, that, and the other. So thank goodness we got PCM, but they still won't put the programs in the main newspaper so that people know, you know, I mean, the announcements, if you will. And that's been the issue. Because a lot of the folks who are running for office, I call their office, they know who I am. Mm-hmm. Because the first thing I'm going to ask you, what do you bring to the table?
Okay.
I did that with the so-called mayor-elect right now. Mm-hmm. We got two right now. We got Charlie Hale and we got Ted Wheeler.
That's right.
We got two right now, see? And Ted sits in the background, and I know where he wants to go. He's waiting for either Earl Blumenthal's seat or Ron Wyden's seat. I know what that's all about.
Really?
But okay. What about the issues here? What about the homeless problems? What have we got this police problem there? I mean, you give me, you go on and on and on, but they don't have any solutions. And it gets even thicker in the media aspect of it. OPB now is in the media business, investigative media aspect of it. But here locally, just happened to hire a couple of people from the Oregonian, and they did the poll for the mayoral race. Well, I was up in the top three, but they wouldn't share that information with everybody. So consequently, they wouldn't invite me to the so-called debates.
Okay.
So they finally invited me because the people finally got the words, hey, you better get Bruce there. So they put me on there. But Ted wouldn't. He wasn't part of my group that I debated with. He was the second group.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm just saying that's what we're dealing with, and that the public needs to know that. I mean, in all due respect, if they figure that I'm fibbing or whatever, I've invited Mr. Wheeler here on a numerous occasion, and I've even told him what he needs to do when he comes here. Like I did Art. I said, hey, if you don't have it, can you solve some of the issues? What do you bring to the table? That's why he's here. But they don't show up. But that's okay, they do show up, right, Richard? Because we're on here and we talk about it.
Your stuff has been very interesting.
You like that?
Really?
See?
Like everything you talked about.
Okay. Any lasting comment that you think we might want to make?
Are we about there?
Can we please invite the rest of the folks who are running for office to come on our show?
Oh, you're welcome.
You might? Okay.
Well, wait a minute now. And we're running out of time, aren't we?
Yeah. Huh?
No, I mean time day-wise.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
When is the election? 7th, 8th?
3 weeks.
8th?
8th of November. So we got one more show, right? Here?
Elections on a Tuesday.
Well, the ballots will go out, and they vote for a couple of weeks.
Oh, that's right.
So it's about 3 weeks in Oregon.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I'll be doing a show on Sundays.
Yeah, Sunday.
I may have to invite you over, though, to do some interviews here, because we understand that we're in the same.
Okay.
That okay with you?
Sure.
Okay, good. So, Art, we want to wish you all the luck in the world.
Well, thank you.
And hopefully this will show them as an example. All of the candidates will do basically what you did. And that is, just tell us what you bring to the table. I don't care if you're Republican, Democrat, Independent, Libertarian. I mean, how many more? You got Constitutional? Give me another one.
Well, I'm also nominated by the Constitution Party, and I'm proud of it.
Okay. Right.
You know, Libertarians have had a lot of good things to say about me, too.
Okay.
Not the Democrats, however.
But you can only join one party to vote.
No, I actually, on the ballot, I'll be listed as Republican and Constitution.
Yeah, but you can only vote once.
Oh, you can only vote once, and I want them all to vote for Robinson.
Well, Republican.
I'm going to vote for Robinson. I highly recommend the guy. I know him pretty well.
You're going to vote for this guy.
I know a lot about him, and I know all his faults, but I still recommend to vote for him.
He's a funny guy, too, Tom. Trust me, he's a very human being, trust me. I know the family. I mean,
knows all his faults.
I had the opportunity to go down there, and he has a real scientific lab and the whole nine yard, and the kids are beautiful. I mean, He's just right. He brings that to the table, and for someone that has a family and willing to sacrifice that time to represent us, you know, you got that says something.
Have all those interests.
The whole family works on this. We all work together on everything we do, including this.
So again, I would say to Peter DeFazio, I mean, if you know Peter, I'd be more than glad to interview Peter. Richard and I, we're more glad to do that and give him the same opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
But I will stress to Peter, please, if you come, please tell us what you bring to the table for the Oregon voter.
Mm-hmm.
Very simple. And then maybe you might have an opportunity to get him and Art together. Would you have a problem sitting on
No, chat? We just debated once, and he's refused to debate more than once.
Yeah,
so I don't
right?
think we'll be together again.
Oh,
gee. I tried to get him to... additional events, but he's refused.
Oh, really?
Well, we had one. The City Club in Eugene scheduled a forum sort of semi-debate for us, and that was last week.
Oh, is that right? Wow. Well, anyway, it may have some sense. That's why I wanted Richard to be a part, because we're part of the baby. We're just a little ahead of the baby. The first round of the baby boomers, right? But we are seniors,
okay.
Right? And military, you got African American, you got a white. I mean,
millennials.
Where are
they?
It's a new term now. Millennium seniors.
That's
the category we fall in, because see, we're an active group. We're not just sitting back, not getting involved. Millennium senior. You like that now?
That sounds pretty good.
Same thing with Art. He's a millennium. He's also a senior too. See.
Okay.
The fact
right.
He's actively. He's getting out there. He's engaging. And that's what we're all about.
Okay.
That's why he's sitting here. That's why he's going to be good if he gets to Congress. You got to get him in there, though.
That's right.
That's the key.
That's
okay?
Right.
Well, folks, look like we're at about that 2-minute mark. And I know we're going to, maybe just while we're still talking, why don't you run the schedules, the reruns again right now, and we'll just keep on rapping a little bit. We got about another minute, I think. Am I right? We got about another minute. Just raise your hand and there we go. There's
two
a minute.
That's okay.
10/16/16 at 11 a.m. on Channel 11. That's October the 16th. That's my birthday.
October the 16th?
16th. October the 16th.
Today's my wife's birthday.
Is that right? Really?
Happy birthday.
Yeah, October 16th. I'm 35 years old now. Don't,
all right.
Don't smile when you say
that.
Well,
you mean 39.
Yes,
any way you like.
That's right. 16.
That's how old Jack Benny was.
Is that what it was?
40 years.
Benny was a good old
Jack
man.
Stuffed at 39, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yes, that's right. He was great. Then there was George Burns. When he was over 100, he walked out on the stage.
Amazing.
He says, I'm glad to be here tonight. He says, at my age, I'm glad to be anywhere tonight, he says.
That's right.
But Jack was 39 forever. That's right. He was terrific.
So what are you going to do for the bill? Are you going to be doing it? Are you going to be knocking any more on doors and all?
Because there are 350,000 doors.
350,000 doors.
So
wow.
I'm spending my time in the ways that I have available to communicate to as many people as possible.
But they can still contact
you. Our radio ads are out there that gets to
a lot. But they can still contact you, right? Yes. You have a number? You got a phone number?
Yeah, 541-499-7821.
Okay, 541-499.
Yeah, 7821. Burn up. That's my personal phone. Burn it up. I won't get all these messages of things I have to do then.
Sounds great.
You won't be able to call me if people call me and raise Cain with me. The left will call.
Is there?
It's okay. Actually, you can communicate through Robinson, artforcongress.com.
Right.
We have
Facebook
a website.
Too. You go on Facebook. You got Facebook. Just hit him, Art Robinson.
They use the internet. Nobody makes phone calls anymore unless they're sending text messages.
Well, folks, thank you very much.
They all
hopefully, we'll share some
email.
Thoughts with you.
Endless
email.
I know.